हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज़ पीयूष गुप्ता एंड टुडे आई विल बी टॉकिंग टू यू अबाउट क्रिएटिंग योर फर्स्ट CI/CD पाइपलाइन विद कुबरनेटिस एंड जेनकिंस। अ क्विक इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट मी, आई वर्क एज अ सीनियर डेवलपर एडवोकेट विद डिजिटल ओशन। इन माय प्रीवियस अवतार आई हैव वर्कड एज अ डेवलपर वेयर आई क्रिएटेड प्लेटफॉर्म्स बेस्ड ऑन क्लाउड नेटिव टेक्नोलॉजीज एंड ऑल्सो हेल्प्ड कस्टमर्स माइग्रेट देयर वर्कलोड From legacy infrastructure to cloud-based infrastructure. I am an active contributor to Kubernetes SIG Contributor project, that's short for contributor experience. You can find me on Kubernetes Slack. My handle there is Pensu91. You can also find me on Twitter with the same handle. Or if you are the kind of person who would rather write down an email, please feel free to shoot one at pgupta@digitalocean.com. Here is going to be the agenda for today. We will talk a bit about what DevOps is, what is CI/CD, what are CI/CD pipelines, what is Jenkins, and we will also take a brief look at why you should use Kubernetes in context of DevOps or in general. And then we will have a look at the demo where we will deploy a Jenkins server on our Kubernetes cluster and run a sample pipeline. And in the end, if the time permits, we will have a Q&A session as well. So let's get started. When I talk about DevOps, as the term indicates, it's a mixture of two different verticals, that's development and operations. And when you mix them, you get DevOps. There is no specific definition to DevOps. It's more of a set of guidelines that you can follow, that you can implement in your organizations, in your team, right? DevOps is more of a culture that you can use to streamline your software lifecycle. If you look at the diagram, it has two cycles. One is the development and another is the operation, right? And I would just talk a bit about the stages that these cycles contain. One of them is the plan stage, and that's where all the things start. Plan stage is where you decide what all features you want in your product and you scope them out, right? You don't want these requirements to be vague so that the coding team has a clear indication of what they want to do. And then once you have jotted down all your requirements, once you are clear what all features you would want your software to have, you move on to the coding part where the development team takes down all the requirements and create those features, right? Basically code those features out. After coding, you move on to the build stage, and the build stage depends on what your delivery vehicle is for your product, right? You want to create a dev package or an RPM package, right? You would want to create a Docker image, right? It could be anything, right? And once you have built that package, you move on to the testing part. And testing is a very important stage. Reason being, before releasing your product out to the outer world, you would want to make sure that there are no defects or bugs with it, right? And testing could be of multiple types. You would want to do unit testing, you want to do integration testing, you want to do end-to-end testing, or you want to run nightly builds, things like that. And once you are confident with your testing, you go on to the release phase. And in releasing, again, it depends on your delivery vehicle. You want to push the binaries to a package manager repo, or you want to push it to a container registry, things like that. Right. And that completes the development cycle. And then we move on to the operation cycle. And in operations, the first step is you deploy your product or your newly built feature set. And depending on what your stack is, you can deploy it to directly to the customer environment, or you can develop it to the production environment, or you might have something like a staging environment, right? Where you would still want to monitor your product, right? And in the next stage, the operate and monitor stage usually work together, right? What it basically means is you operate on your product, you test out all the feature set that you claim to have, and you run it for quite some time. When you are doing testing, it's not feasible to run those tests for a longer period of time because that slows down the development cycle. But when you are in the operate part, it basically checks how your product behaves on a longer period of time, let's say for a couple of weeks, right, or for a couple of days, right, depending on what granularity you are looking at. And then while you are operating on the product, you monitor the resource uses, right, the workflow, how it happens, right? You don't want memory leaks to happen on a longer period of time. You don't want unusual CPU spikes, right? And all these things work as a feedback to the next cycle. So if you look at the diagram, the monitor stage again goes back to the plan stage. Monitor stage provides you valuable feedbacks, as in if there are unusual memory usages, or if there is a workflow that can be optimized in a better way, or it could be more user friendly, those kind of things. And then you again move on to the dev cycle, and that works as a feedback for your development teams, right? So why DevOps? And I touched a bit about it in the previous slide, and one of the biggest benefit of using DevOps cycles is it helps you increase productivity, because there are a lot of set guidelines that helps your team optimize their workflow, right? It helps them understand how the product should look like, right? And there are feedback loops in all of these stages. So if there is something that is going wrong, you can always go back and fix that. You don't need to wait until the last moment when your product is deployed, right, in a production or in a customer environment to catch those issues. And that in turn increases profitability. When your customers are using the product, or when you are in operate and monitoring phase, you get key feedback that you can include in your next development cycle. And that makes your product better over the time. The second and third point are almost similar. DevOps helps you get faster software lifecycle, and it also helps you shorter your time to market. And one thing that I would want to point out here is about automation. Like, automation is one of the core, one of the most important component when we are talking about DevOps. And you can automate almost anything across that cycle, except I guess the coding the features part, right? But other than that, you can automate your building stages, you can automate your testing stages, the release cycle, the deployment cycle, right? And when you automate these things, you basically reduce human intervention, and that helps you do these things in a much faster way, right? Where you don't need somebody doing all this work for you, right? All these things can be done using automation tools or scripts, right? And that actually helps you to detect and correction of bugs and defects as well. When you are running your automated builds, when you are running your automated tests, they actually help you to detect those defects in a faster way than you would have done when you are doing all the stuff manually, right? And as we said, DevOps is not just one thing. It's a set of guidelines. It's a group of multiple things that can benefit your software lifecycle. Similarly, there is no one specific DevOps tool, right? What you see on your screen is there are multiple buckets, and you can use any one of these tools, or a group of these tools, or a combination of these tools to implement DevOps in your organization or in your teams. I will just talk a bit about these tools. We are not going to go in depth discussion of this particular slide, right? In the beginning, you have infrastructure as a code, and what it basically does is it helps you create repeatable infrastructure. Now, think of a way where you want to test a feature pretty quickly. And then if you have to wait for somebody to create that environment, create that infrastructure, and then only you can test it, it delays the testing and the building phases or building stages, right? So you have got tools like Ansible, Puppet, Chef, Terraform, right? That's also a pretty good tool to use as infrastructure as a code, right? And you can just run those scripts and create the environment and test out your features. Then you have got CI/CD tools. They help you in multiple stages when you are continuously creating new features, adding them to the mainline code, helping you in deploying those new features to the specific environment, right? And then you have test automation, right? You would want, and testing, as we discussed, is a pretty important phase. So you would want testing to be automated as well so that you can detect bugs and issues earlier. And then containers in the modern times have become an important part of DevOps cycle, mainly because they are pretty resource efficient and also pretty fast. And then when you are using containers, of course, you need to use an orchestration environment as well. And you can choose anyone you like, Kubernetes, OpenShift, or Docker Swarm, depending on your preferences. And then deployment is again part of the CI/CD pipelines as well. It can be implemented as a standalone bucket, or it can be used in combination with CI/CD tools as well. And then finally, you have measurement. Measurement is basically related to monitoring. You can use ELK Stack or something like Datadog to monitor your environment and your deployments. And if you see in the diagram, we see Jenkins in multiple places, and we will talk a bit about that in a minute. Right, now let's talk about continuous integration, and short for CI. CI is basically a mechanism where you can integrate your working copy of the code, or where you can integrate a new feature with a stable code, right? A better way to look at it is, you have a stable code. Let's say you have released your software and it is at version 1. Now you would want to add some new features to it. How do you add a new feature without breaking the original workflow, right? So that the new code doesn't make some destructive changes, so to say. CI tools help you do that, right? You can use any of the tools. You can use Jenkins. You can use Travis CI. And Travis CI is one of my favorite because it integrates with GitHub pretty nicely. You have to just make few clicks, and you can enable Travis CI on your repos, and then you can test any change, any new feature or any new change that is coming in before merging it with the mainline code. And you can also use Concourse for that. Now, let's talk about continuous deployment or delivery. It depends which stage you have been talking about. And it is CD is basically the mechanism where you can deploy applications in a production environment or in a staging environment after it meets the well-defined criteria, usually like passing all the test cases. So once you are comfortable, or once you are confident about your test cases, you can just go and deploy that particular package, whatever you created from the build stage, either in a production or in a staging environment, right? And again, there are multiple tools that can help you do that, something like Jenkins, Spinnaker, and Argo. One thing that you will notice is we had Jenkins as a CI tool as well, and we also have Jenkins as a CD tool. Let's see why that happens. So Jenkins at the core is an open source automation server. So if you remember, we talked about that Automation is one of the core concepts of DevOps, and Jenkins helps you automate anything that you throw at it, right? It was started in 2004, right, at Sun. And originally, it was called Project Hudson. It started by Kosuke Kawaguchi. I hope I'm pronouncing the name right. And he was facing the same issue whenever he had to create a new feature, or whenever he wanted to make some changes, he had to do a lot of manual work to test it to make sure that things are working fine. So he came up with an idea, what if I can automate some of the repetitive tasks, right? And that's how Jenkins was born, right? One of the good thing about Jenkins is it supports a lot of plugins, right? There are literally hundreds of plugins that you can use along with Jenkins. Last I checked, there was about 1600 or 1700 plugins, right? So no matter what tech stack you have been using in your environment, there is a very high chance that you would find a Jenkins plugin for it. And then Jenkins has integration with leading cloud providers and source control management repositories. No matter if you are using GitHub or GitLab or any other SVN, you will probably find a plugin that can integrate your source control management tools with Jenkins. And finally, let's talk a bit about Kubernetes as well. I assume if you are in this talk, you would have at least heard about Kubernetes. And Kubernetes provides a lot of benefits in your organizational infrastructure, right? Kubernetes is resource efficient. It essentially runs containers or pods, and pods are basically a group of containers. Containers are pretty resource efficient. They are very small in size, and you know they can boot up pretty fast. And that also helps in increasing productivity, right? Since containers can boot up pretty fast, and you know, so that you don't have to wait for the infrastructure to get ready. It usually happens within few seconds, and then you can run your code and you can test out whatever new feature you have added, and you can get the results out pretty quickly. And then Kubernetes provides you a concept of services that you can use to provide high availability to your applications, right? Scalability is also pretty easy with Kubernetes. You can just run one command that, okay, I need 10 copies of my application, and Kubernetes will make sure that you have 10 copies of your application running at that point of time. And if you just want to scale down, you can just say, okay, scale it down to, let's say, 3 copies, and Kubernetes will do that. And one of the most powerful feature of Kubernetes is the declarative API. You don't need to be you don't need to have big programming knowledge to interact with Kubernetes cluster. You can either use a YML or a JSON file where you just tell Kubernetes that this is my application, I need this many copies, and this is the image or a container image that you are supposed to use. And now onus is on Kubernetes to make sure that happens. Now, enough talk. Let's look at the demo. Let me just switch back to my terminal. Right. So for this demo, I am basically using two clusters. Let me just show you. Right. So if you see on the screen, you have got three clusters running. The top cluster is for some other purposes, but the bottom two clusters, the Jenkins demo and the Kubernetes table, we will be using them for today's demo. So since Jenkins deployment and configuration takes some time, so I have already a setup created where all the configuration is done, where all the plugins are already installed, right? Just to save us some time. And Jenkins demo is the cluster where we will actually go and deploy Jenkins. So we will just do a back and forth between these two clusters, right? I just wanted to show you the setup. Let's see which cluster we are in right now. Perfect. So we are in the Jenkins demo cluster, where we will be deploying the Jenkins deployment or Jenkins server. Right. Now, we will be deploying Jenkins as a deployment. That's one of the core Kubernetes resources, right? And I have a YML file created. Let me just walk you through it. Right. So if you look at it, I have set up the API version. That's apps/v1. I'm using Kubernetes 1.18.8. The API version might depend on what version you are using. So just make sure that you are in right API group, because Kubernetes is a highly evolving project. There are a lot of features that keep moving from alpha to beta to stable, right? So just make sure you are using the right API group. And the kind is deployment. I have given it a name, and then I have used that app.appjenkins. I'm using it as a selector. And then I'm just running one replica. Since this is just a demo environment, I'm just running one replica. But if you want a high availability kind of a setup, I would recommend you use more than one of these, so that if any one of the server goes down, you would still have, or your users would still have access to the server. And then the magic happens inside the spec section. So here I'm running just one container, and my container name is going to be Jenkins. I will be using an LTS image that's from official Jenkins repository, right? And I'm exposing two ports here, right? One is an HTTP port, another is GNLP port. Now, what these ports do is, for an HTTP port, it is used to access Jenkins UI, right? When you are working with Jenkins server, you would have to access the UI to add new agents, to create jobs. You know, we will just have a look at that. And then GNLP port is for GNLP agents to report back to the Jenkins server, right? This is where your Jenkins server will listen on the incoming GNLP connections. And then I'm mounting a volume. That volume is just an empty directory. This will go away once the pod goes away. But if you want to persist this data, if you would want to make sure that there is some data that should still be preserved, even if the pod goes down, you can use any of the other ways to mount the volume. You can use either host path or NFS volume or an EBS volume or GlusterFS, depending on what your stack looks like. Now, let's deploy this Jenkins server. So apply -f Jenkins.yml. Right. So what it will do is, it will basically create a Jenkins server in my Kubernetes cluster. It's going to take a few seconds to do that, right? Now, we have a deployment Jenkins created. Let's check if our pod is in running state. Perfect. That means our Jenkins server has run, right? Now, in Kubernetes world, when you are when you create a new application or when you create a new deployment, the way to access it is via services, right? So you use services to expose your application. So I have a service YML file as well. As all good things in Kubernetes, like, we have YML for everything. Right. Now, if you look at this YML, I am basically creating two services. One of the services is named as Jenkins, and it is exposed as type node port. Right. What it does is, it exposes the port 8080 to the node port 30,000. Right. Now, when I create a service as the type node port, it basically exposes that particular port on all of the nodes, Right. So, whenever I go to any of the worker nodes in my Kubernetes cluster on this particular pod, let's say 30,000, I would be redirected to the Jenkins deployment, right? And how the service does that, or how Kubernetes knows where to send those requests, happens via the selector, right? So this is nothing but an IP tables rules, right? And kubeproxy is the agent that runs on every nodes and take care of setting all those IP table rules. Second is our Jenkins JNLP service. And this service, as I mentioned earlier, is about listening connections from the JNLP agents. Now, if you notice here, the type I have selected is cluster IP, because this service doesn't need to be accessed from outside. Right, because we will be creating those JNLP agents inside the Kubernetes cluster itself, so they can reach the Jenkins server just via or just inside the cluster itself. They don't need to be this port doesn't need to be open to the outside connections, hence the cluster IP. And we are using the same selector here. Let me deploy. Or let me create services as well. Once I do this, it will create two services. One is the Jenkins service, and another is Jenkins JNLP service. Right. Let's just check if our services are deployed or not. Right. So we have got two services. One is Jenkins, another is Jenkins JNLP. I would want to show you one more thing regarding these services. Let me just describe my Jenkins service. So every service has an resource called endpoint, right? And this is where the service is supposed to route the request. So if you see here, the endpoint has been updated to the pod IP and the port that we have exposed. If you remember, we exposed the port 8080 to the port 30,000, right? And that's exactly what this service is doing. Next, now we have created the deployment, we have created the service. Next, we would access the Jenkins UI. So if you remember, I have been exposing the Jenkins server using node port. That means I should be able to go to any of the node IP and the 30,000 port, and I should be able to access the Jenkins server. Let's get the nodes IP. Since these are DigitalOcean hosted Kubernetes clusters, I would have two set of IPs. One would be a private IP and one would be a public IP. For this particular demo, we are looking at the public IP or the external IP. Let's go to the second node and we'll just go back to the browser. I will copy the IP and the port 30,000. And there we go. Right. So this is our Jenkins UI. And you get this setup instructions for the first time when you are deploying Jenkins. If you don't want to see it, there is a flag that you can set and you won't get the setup wizard. But I wanted to show it for the demo purposes, right? Now, when you start with Jenkins, the first thing you need to do is you have to unlock it, right? And for unlock, there is a password that you need to provide. You can find this password either in the Jenkins pod log, or you can exec into that pod and go to this particular location. So let's go back to our terminal. And I will just, what I'm trying to do here is I will just check the logs of the pod and we should find the password there. Right. And you can find the logs simply using kubectl logs and the pod name. It's gonna take a few seconds to get the logs from the pod, right? Okay, and here is the password that we can use. And if you don't want to check the logs, you can just go to this particular location and you can find this password, right? I will just copy and paste it here and I will go to continue. The next step is Jenkins will expect me to install some suggested plugins. These are the plugins that are used by developers across the globe. You can choose to install them at this point of time, or you can also install them at a later stage. So, and you can also choose to select which plugin you would want to install at the startup time. For this demo, I'm just gonna select none. Right now we are not going to install any of the plugin. And then I go to install. You are expected to create an admin user, and you should do that when you are doing it in a production like environment. But for the demo purpose, I'm just going to skip it. And then you can set up an instance configuration. This is going to be the URL which other applications can use to talk to your Jenkins server. And you can click on save and finish. And before you get started with using Jenkins, you will get a notification of what you have skipped in the setup workflow, right? So we skipped setting up of an admin user. It will just tell you that you have skipped that. And then you can just go to start using Jenkins. That's it, right? So our server setup is complete, right? Now, the next thing is you have to set up an agent. Now, before that, if you look, you would always find there are two build executors available, right? Even though we didn't add any agent to the server. And that happens because when you create a Jenkins master, it by default create executors for the master itself, right? And you wouldn't want to have that. When you are running a master or an agent kind of an architecture, you would want to keep the master only to do the master operations, right? Like scheduling or controlling those kind of operations. So what we are going to do is we will just disable these executors. You can click on the build executor status. You can go to the master, configure, and just put that as zero. And your executors are gone. That's good. Let's go back to the home page. Now, when you go to the home page, it tells you either you need to create an agent or you need to configure a cloud, right? So that you can set up the builds. Now, we don't want to create an agent here. You can do that. You can create a pool of nodes that you can add to the Jenkins server, and they can be used to execute your builds. But in this case, we will be configuring a cloud. Our use case is to use Kubernetes as a cloud agent for Jenkins. Now, when you go to configure a cloud, it will ask you to install plugins, right? Since we didn't install any plugins as part of the startup, we will have to do it now. You can go to Plugin Manager and it will show you all the cloud providers that are available as plugins, right? It's going to take a few seconds to load. And you can find virtually any cloud provider you use as a plugin available here. If you want to use Docker, if you would want to use Kubernetes, that's what we will do. You want to use EC2 instances, Azure, right? Adobe, right? Cloudify, anything. I believe there is a plugin for DigitalOcean as well, right? So you can use that plugin to create DigitalOcean instances on demand. Right, let's go back to our list. And Kubernetes is the plugin that we are actually looking for. Let me just search for it. Right, so you have the you have got the Kubernetes plugin here. You just click on it and install without restart. So what it's going to do is now it's going to install the Kubernetes plugin along with it, along with all the dependencies that comes with the plugin, right? So it's gonna take a few minutes. Let's move back to our stable cluster where we have Jenkins deployed and configured. Let me just log into that. I will fetch the password. Right. So let me just show you on the terminal as well by switching the context. That context, and then I will just switch over the stable cluster where all the setup is done. Right now, I have the similar setup here. I have got a Jenkins pod running, that is my Jenkins server, and I have got the similar services running, the Jenkins and the JNLP service. Right now, I want to show you how I have configured the Kubernetes cloud here. So you can go to configure clouds option. And once you have installed that plugin, the Kubernetes plugin, you will find the Kubernetes cloud options here. The important information here is you have to set up the Kubernetes URL. You can get this URL easily by typing kubectl cluster info. It will tell you where your Kubernetes master is running, right? So my master is running on this URL. The URL might be different based on your environment. I'm using DigitalOcean Kubernetes clusters. So my URL is basically on digitalocean.com. And once you have put in the URL here, you can just click on test connections and it should show that you are connected to Kubernetes. Now, before doing this, just make sure that your service account has access to create pods and list pods and all those operations, because when you connect to the Kubernetes cloud, Jenkins server will basically direct that cloud to create new pods as a worker agent and delete those pods, execute some commands inside those pods. Now to do that, you need to have proper accesses. So just make sure that your cluster role or your RBAC policies allow the service account that you are using with the Jenkins pod to do all those operations. Then you have the Jenkins URL setup that we used in the instance configuration. And then you have to set up a Jenkins tunnel. And this tunnel is basically our JNLP service. So if you look at the terminal, this is the IP, right, that we are using here. And the port is 50,000. That's the port we exposed as cluster IP. And then the interesting thing is you have to set up a pod template. Like I'm calling this pod as JNLP. And here are some details. I'm using a JNLP slave label, right? And what labels do is they help you restrict where your particular job should run, right? So if and you can use that as a setting. If you want to only build jobs with label expression matching this particular node, so this particular agent will only run those jobs that have this label set up. But since we only have this node, right, we are not setting up any other agent, I am going to use this node as much as possible. And then you have to set up container templates. The container name, I'm keeping it similar, JNLP. I'm using the Docker image as Jenkins CI/JNLP slave. If I remember correctly, there were talks about deprecating this image. And there is a new image coming up that is called JNLP inbound or something. Just make sure you are using the right image here. You can set up commands to run. You can set up environment variables that you would want your job to have. You can add volumes if you want to share some data with the job, some confidential data that you don't want to be a part of job configuration or the agent configuration, and any kind of volume you can mount. And there are a lot of other configuration options that we are not going in detail about. You can set up user IDs, group IDs to make your workflow more secure. And that's all. Right? That's how you can configure a Kubernetes cloud as an agent. Now, let's verify if the things are working fine. Right? So you can go to create a job, and I'm just going to create a test job. I will be creating a freestyle project just to make sure things are working fine. Right? And you get some configuration options here. Right? You can set up labels. Right? If you remember, we set up the label as VNLP slave. Right? And when you select that label, it will tell you who are all the agents who are serving this particular label. So it says it matches no nodes. That's perfect because we have not set up any nodes as of now. And it does serve one cloud, right? That's our Kubernetes cloud, right? So that we are good to go. You can choose source code management. You can choose build triggers. You can set up build environment, right? Now, and you can add a build step, right? And this is what we are planning to do. And I'm just going to add a shell command here. Let's say it's not doing much. The job will basically sleep for 60 seconds. And that will give us an opportunity to observe what is happening in the environment. You can save it, and then you can click on build now. Now, when you do that, you will find the build here, and it will basically wait for the next available executor, right? Because the only executor we have at this point is our Kubernetes cloud. So Jenkins will reach out to Kubernetes API server, and it would say that, okay, I have got an incoming request for a build, and I need you to create a agent pod where I can run this particular job. And if you go to the console output of that job, you will see that my command is running. Let's go back to the terminal and just check if the pod or if the job is actually running on a Kubernetes pod. Now, when you do that, when you do a kubectl get pods, you should see a Jenkins pod and also a JNLP pod. Now, this Jenkins pod is our Jenkins server, and the JNLP pod is basically the agent that was created by Jenkins server. Now, going back to our job, you'll see this is the pod YML that is being sent to the Kubernetes API server. And it has some of the environment variables that tell that particular pod where it has to connect back to, right? Because once the JNLP agent is up and running, it needs to connect back to the Jenkins server to tell that, okay, I'm up and running now and I'm ready to accept jobs. And once that happens, Jenkins will send the instructions that we have set up in our build environment, and those instructions would be executed. And once it's done, it will just print finished as success, right? So, and if you look at the terminal, you would see that the pod is now gone, right? So this gives you a pretty resource efficient and quick way to run your DevOps cycles. Now, let's create a pipeline. The flow is same. You go to the new item. Let's call it test pipeline. You choose pipeline from here. And then you click on OK. And then again, you get a lot of configuration options that you can do. You can set up build triggers, right? You can set up a GitHub webhook. So whenever a new change comes to your GitHub repository, you can just Take those changes and run your pipeline and run your test, run your build stage, and make sure that things are fine with that new feature or with that new change. And then the core part of the pipeline is in the pipeline definition. So pipeline definition is nothing but a set of stages that the pipeline is supposed to execute. Right? You can either put a pipeline script here, or you can pull that pipeline script from a source control management repository, right? This is a better way to do things, because tomorrow, if you want to change your pipeline definition, you don't need to change the job itself. You can just change the pipeline definition in your source control management repository, be it GitHub or GitLab or anything like that. And the change would be reflected in the job directly. You can choose Git, you can add plugins for other SCMs as well. Like for this demo, we will just use the pipeline script. And there are options to try out. If this is your first time creating a pipeline, you can use Kubernetes-based pipelines, or you can use a simple Hello World. Now, looking at this pipeline, you will feel, you will see that there is an agent any, right? And this is also one way to restrict where your pipeline should run, right? When I say any, that means this pipeline can run anywhere on any of the executors. And then you have got stages, and stages basically contains what are all the stage in that pipelines are. And each stage has a set of steps, right? So this is a pretty simple pipeline. Let me get the pipeline with more than one stages in, right? That would be a good way to showcase how the pipelines work. Right. Now, if you see here, we are still keeping the agents as any, right? And we have got three stages. First stage is you pull the repository, right? And you just run a git clone command. And there is a plugin for Git as well, so you don't need to manually run Git clone. But just for this demo, I'm just using Git clone. You can print a Python version, right? Let's say that is one of the commands that you would want to run. And then you just go inside the repository and run the Python file. And it doesn't do much. That file just prints Hello World. But what I want to show you is you can also have conditions in these stages. Let's say you want to test on a specific Python version. So you can check that first, and after it has run, you can, after you are sure that this is the Python version I want to test my pipeline on, you can run this command. If this fails, you can just call the pipeline as a failed pipeline, right? So there are lots of checks and balances you can do. And then you just go on build now. Now, when you click on build now, the request goes to the Jenkins server. Jenkins talk to the Kubernetes cloud. The Kubernetes cloud creates an agent pod, and all the instructions are run inside that pod. Now, let's take a look if the pod is coming up or not. Right. So, wow, that was pretty quick. So before I could get the pod information, my pipeline has run and the pod has been terminated, right? But what I want to show you is, you see, this is the pod YML that went to the Kubernetes server, and it ran these three steps that I wanted it to run. It cloned the repo, printed out the Python version, and it run my Python script, right? And once all of these things went well, it just finished as success. Also, if you go to the pipeline page, it will show you that this particular pipeline has these three stages and what was the result, right? If it failed, it will also show you the failure logs. You can go through them, you can understand what went wrong and what else you need to modify, right? Among other things, right? This is a simple example of a pipeline that you can create using Jenkins and Kubernetes. You can modify these pipeline according to your specific needs. You want to create an integration pipeline, or you want to create a deployment pipeline based on, I mean, you can create multiple pipelines as well, and based on the result of one pipeline, you would trigger another one, right? So there are a lot of permutations and combinations you can do, and the exact output depends on what your configuration is, what your tech stack is. Let's go back to our presentation. So that's all I had. Thank you for being a brilliant audience. And if you would want to talk about Jenkins, DevOps, Kubernetes, anything, please get in touch. You can reach out on LinkedIn, you can reach out on Twitter or on email. And if you would want to try out DigitalOcean, you can go to the link given. That's do.co/Piyush. P is capital there. And you can get $100 credits to try out any of the resources you want. Thank you for watching.